The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Well, this is a very, very special episode of the David Feldman Show. The world's smartest man is with us in our lovely studio here.
Not to be contentious, but it's the smartest man in the world.
What did I say?
The world's smartest man. I'm a Mel Brooks sketch when I'm on your show.
Yes.
The 2,000-year-old smartest man.
Well, help me out, because I just got off the phone doing a bit, so I'm a little frazzled.
I see.
World,
it's hard for you to get back to the real world when you're in character because of your craft and your commitment to it.
Well, all right, so
show is called The Smartest Man in the World, the podcast.
Smartest Man in the World.
And but you can call me the world's smartest man if you like.
Well, you are.
Thank you.
And Smartest Man in the World book.
Yes.
That's the name.
It's called The Smartest Book in the World.
The Smartest Book in the World.
See what I did? I branded.
So far, you're 0 for 2, Feldo.
And that's Dan Pasternack, and I need you to help me because I can't keep up with this man, Greg Proops.
I'll do the best I can.
Alex Bennett.
Yes.
Who is Alex Bennett?
Alex Bennett was a radio show host. He'd been around, New York, Texas, all that jazz in the 60s, and then came to San Francisco, I presume, in the early 80s, mm-hmm. late 70s. And then he had a show there that had all the comics on live every morning for, 3 hours? The first hour was him with the news person. Then the second 3 hours, the last 3 hours of the show, was comics live. So you, Warren Thomas, Bob Rubin, mm-hmm. Matt Weinhold, Marin, everybody. I remember doing it with everybody. And meeting, because everyone who did a press junket that came through San Francisco did his show. So I remember meeting, I remember meeting Agnieszka Holland, the movie director, Dennis Farina, Eric Stoltz. I can think of about Donny Osmond, Britt Eklund. I remember meeting.
Was that all one show?
Yes. And what a show that was. Donny Osmond, Agnieszka Holland, and Britt Eklund is an unforgettable radio hour. you would meet all these other famous people that were coming through town as well as being with all the comics. And then whoever was playing in town that was an out-town headliner. So he really promoted comedy in a huge way in the mid-80s in San Francisco. And he didn't like me at first, which he always brings up, but then we got to be friends, and he put on these live shows. So it'd be like me, David, Warren, Alan. What's his name?
Alan
from Texas. He was one of the Kinison guys. Alan Steven. It'd be like those kind of shows, and there'd be 4 or 5 comics, and everybody get high, and you know, Ruben be there, whatnot, and he paid good money, and that was the thing. So if you did his show a bunch, you could fill your club. And those days, there were 10 full-time clubs in the Bay Area. And 3 in San Francisco. So you could
Greg, name them now.
Well, there was the Punchline, the Holy City Zoo, Cobb's, the Improv opened later. And then in the East Bay, there was Tommy T's. There was a Punchline in Walnut Creek as well. There was a club in San Jose that I don't think I ever played.
Rooster
T Feathers in Sunnyvale. And they all went all the time.
Foo Bars.
That's the one. John's Club. Martinez. Moved. It was in one place.
Pleasanton,
yeah. And they all went 7 days a week, or at least 5 days a week. And so if you were playing, I remember I hosted Alex's show 1 week, because he was on vacation or something, and I was playing Rooster T Feathers, and I filled the place every night, because all you had to, you were on for 4 hours a day. And they loved when I would guest host, because I mentioned the call letters. Alex never did the signature right. He never went, "You're listening to The Quake," or whatever it was,
right.
Or Live 105, I guess it was at that point. And I said it every 2 seconds. So they were like, "That was a great show, Greg." No matter what I did, it was a great show. Because this is Greg Proops on Live 105. We'll be right back on Live 105. And they were like, "Oh my God, you say the name of the station 1,000 times, and that's all we really want."
What was Alex's psychology? He just was a professional curmudgeon, and he would bite the hand that fed him.
Absolutely.
Which doesn't exist anymore.
No, he was, they would call it a shock jock, I guess, in those days, but he wasn't like Stern. It wasn't very stripper, although I met a few porn stars on the show. It wasn't that stripper porn oriented sit on a vibrator thing. It was really way more about comedy.
And politics, and Stern admits that he learned a lot by listening to Alex on WPLJ and WMCA. And that's why Alex came to Sirius. I mean, Stern was influenced by
absolutely. And then Alex was always as you say, a curmudgeon. If Stern got brought up on the show in the old days, mm-hmm. he'd go, "Oh, Howard Stern, I can't believe that guy." And then he'd go off into a 15-minute tangent about how much he hated Stern. Having said that, Alex had a real conscience, and he was anti-death penalty. He was pro-choice for all of his purported, you know, misanthropy and misogyny on the air. He really wasn't a bad guy. He had a good heart, and he was nice to us, you know.
He was nice to us, and he's still alive, by the way. He's just not talking to me because I'm in New York and I haven't called him.
But well, that's why, David.
I know, he's pissed off at me, but I'm going through a hard time, and having to talk to Alex when you're going through a hard time makes it harder.
David, we're all going out to Rockaway this weekend. I think he helped Bob Rubin probably more than any comic because Rubin, when I first saw him, was a bartender at the Zoo and used to do awesome conceptual routines, which now would be considered avant by the new wave of young comedians. He would go, I remember he plugged a hairdryer into the sack of the socket. You remember this one? He plugged a hairdryer into the socket on the stage at the Holy City Zoo and put the microphone in front of it and then get two flashlights out and just go like this for like 10 minutes, right? Like he's pulling planes in. And he went from that to being a giant headliner in San Francisco via so much exposure on Alex's show. His bits were known. When you played with Bob, people would scream out his bits, mm-hmm. and he could do interaction with the audience.
I was always surprised that Rubin didn't get more traction in TV. I remember Roseanne did...
Yeah, the Saturday Night Special.
Saturday Night Special. And I remember, like, seeing these really inspired, very conceptual pieces, and I thought, like, oh, God, someone's going to... You know, when the show doesn't last, it seemed inevitable it wouldn't. Someone's going to pick him up and use him as a Michael Richards kind of character in a sitcom or something, because he had that kind of, you know, big, huge, hard laugh kind of comedy.
By the way, that's Stan Pasternak.
It is. You said that before.
I introduced you, and you're responsible for Marin's show and Comedy Bang Bang and...
Well, if you want to use the word responsible, I don't know whether you're crediting or blaming.
You were one of Jonathan Winter's closest friends, which I think is the most important thing to say about you.
That one I will accept. Thank you.
And interviewed Jonathan and helped venerate him, which is something that we were talking about before you came in. You were doing your comedy bit downstairs and had no time for us. And that's what we were talking about, was that no one goes around like Ray Elliott just died. Bob Elliott, pardon me. I mixed Ray Goulding with Bob Elliott. Goes around and gets the old comics and just talks to them for hours. He said, what was it, Burrell you interviewed?
Milton Burrell said Caesar, Bob Newhart. A lot of these guys have had, mostly for this project for the Television Academy called the Archive of American Television, these expansive conversations that are, you know, several hours long. A great one with Bernie Brillstein, a great one with George Schlatter.
Yeah.
And I mean, you know, these people and their stories are the foundation upon which I think we stand.
Absolutely. And they're a total resource, and no one goes to them. And show business is so ratty that way. I mean, that's the brilliance of podcasting, is at least, for better or worse, we're going to have our say in this generation. Mm-hmm. You only wish there was a podcast when Jonathan Winters was swinging, because imagine his podcast each week if you just turned the mic on.
It would
and
still be
him.
Going.
Right. It would be one continuous 25,000
hour. Number of podcasts. You know, I put them together with Marin. Uh-huh. And we did a great WTF with Mark, and Mark was great with them.
Yeah.
Our friend Kelly Carlin did a lengthy interview with them that was great. And then Overton had him on Overview as well. And I think that may have been the last one.
And the Green Room. Prevenza had him on the Green Room.
Well, yeah. I helped set that up for Paul. And and Jonathan absolutely destroyed.
Yeah.
And it's probably one of my favorite days on the planet, because it really was, it was a beautiful moment for Jonathan, not only to realize how beloved and respected he was, but to also, you know, show that, you know, the lion could still roar. He was great. He was great on that.
Well, the thing, Dan and I had this conversation last August, but the thing about Jonathan is, people always talk about improv and all this jazz, and I get asked about improv. He's the greatest improviser of all time. He didn't need a group. He didn't need other people to tag him out. He didn't need a premise. He came on stage and did it. And I remember interviewing about his albums and saying, did you ever write down the thing? And he went, no, I improvised all these albums. And you're like, this is astounding. And he's the quickest. the darkest, the most satirical. He had a hard edge that people don't really remember about him. You know, venal politicians, self-absorbed children, horny old ladies. He didn't actually, he was cuddly because he looked so cuddly and he was lovable. And that's how he got away with doing like murderous policemen as characters and stuff. When so I put him up, I mean, Robin, obviously, because Robin was a force of nature and extraordinary and his recall and his intelligence. But if you want to just lay it down, like who's the greatest improviser of all time, I don't think there's any argument. And that counts Second City and every other great improv group.
I mean, when you say greatest improviser,
I only mean his originality.
The honor of being a true improviser, in that most other guys will draw from previous improv sessions. He was pure. He didn't go into – everything was new.
He might have had licks that he hit on again. I mean, you know, certainly characters. I think the last time I saw him and Robin, we were at some horrible benefit in Pasadena or something. And he started doing the Indian chief, right? Which I, you know, hey, right, like that. And Robin went like this to him. And Jonathan turned and went, don't ever touch me. And that made me cry laughing.
Was Robin telling him not to go into
He was simply performing with him and doing a thing. And he went like that.
Now, you are known to many for your improv skills.
Yes.
And
and there's an example of it right there.
There was. That's how you do it. Because I got lucky and got on Whose Line a long time ago, and I'm one of – a kid came up to me the other night at a show in Oklahoma, and he goes, I want to make a living as an improviser. What advice can you give me? And I had to stifle myself because I was like, you're not going to make a living as an improviser. It's like – I said, I'm one of eight people that even comes close to making – and I don't make my living. I'm a stand-up. I do lots of other stuff.
By the way, there's no five-year plan to being an improviser. That's not improvisation.
It's like – I'm on a TV show that's the only improv TV show, and now we're on our fourth year. It's 26 years into this, and it was pure luck at the beginning, you know what I mean? Or whatever.
Because you went to England.
Yeah, and so, right, it was an English TV show, so it was luck that I got on it, luck that the people who got on it.
But in terms of taking those improv skills, don't you feel that there are now more opportunities in film and television for actors who are improvisers to bring those skills?
No question.
Like Judd uses a lot of improvisation.
Well, he does, and the entire cast of SNL and all the sketches are people all
and
from
all
improv
of the
groups.
Feral McKay movies.
Yeah, of course. I think there's a lot of
Larry David.
Right, there's a lot of room to do it. And right, Larry David improvised his show. Well, I don't know. I never did one of them, but if I had a writer like Larry David, I wouldn't be improvising in front of them that much. You know what I mean? I would go like, "Here, can I have a line here to make this funnier?" I always felt like that.
I was the angry Jew in the baptism episode.
Right. So did you
yes,
guys really improvise
yes,
everything? Larry
yes.
didn't give people lines.
He would let you improvise, and then he'd say, "Do it again, but don't do that one."
Right.
So now, how did you find your character? What were you drawing upon as the angry Jew?
I don't know.
Being a Methodist, as you are.
A Methodist, yes.
A Methodist actor. So he didn't give lines to people, but he did direct.
He said, you know, this is your friend of Bob's, and you are mad that he's converting to Christianity, and you want him to come back to the fold. Walk up to him and say something. And I didn't know what the F I was doing.
Right.
But Rick Overton, I think you know Rick Overton, Dan Pashman.
I know the Rick Overton.
Gave me the greatest advice, because you know how constipated I am as an actor. He goes, just whisper. I go, what? Yeah. He says, just whisper. He says, you'll be able to improvise, and it'll seem like acting. Mm. And now whenever... Yeah, I walked up to Larry, and I said, hey, I'd like you to speak at my daughter's butt. That's
right. It made it much easier.
Yeah, just whisper. Bring it down.
Isn't that brilliant? Well, Rick's such a... He's such a nurturing dude, and it's such a key thing to say to someone.
Uh-huh.
That's extraordinary.
Don't be big. So with improv, you've lived in both worlds. Very few comics.
Right. Overton does.
Overton did.
Robin did. And not that many. But improvisers hate comics for some reason, and comics hate improvisers, and I understand both.
Why do you understand why comics? Here's my theory as a stodgy, constipated stand-up who says to an audience, here's my brick, here's another brick, here's another brick. Hang on, I'm going to pause for dramatic effect. And another brick.
Right.
I always feel that improv people are self-destructive because they're when they stumble into something absolutely brilliant, it's lost for the ages. And I'm too greedy to come up with something that's absolutely brilliant and not be able to repeat myself. That's not. I'm not saying I hate improv people. I don't understand it.
Well, I mean, there's two ways to look at the universe, this way and the other way. No, I think with improv... With improv, there's no finite limit to humor. So, like, I improvise my podcast every week, a good deal of it, other than what I'm reading out of the newspaper. And I did a big, long thing last night that I don't remember because I was kind of high. And if I go back and listen to it, I could probably piece it together. But I can never be bothered to go back and, like, write it all down. I'd rather make it up on stage and then try to remember it and then work through it that way. But I think the reason why most comics hate improvisers is they think, well, you're doing the same thing all the time, and it's just crappy games. And my favorite comment ever was, why not prepare something funny? And which is true. And then improvisers hate comics because they think comics are self-absorbed and want to cut to the joke immediately and, and don't honor the stage somehow or whatever. And I don't agree with either of those. I mean, I think you can be funny both ways.
Okay, so you're on...
Yeah, I mean, the interesting thing is I do feel, because I sort of draw upon both groups for a lot of projects that I work on, and I feel like this is an interesting, maybe I think an interesting thing to liken it to. So my wife and I, my wife is actually sitting here right now, we talk about, you know, planning a vacation, and do you want to go back to the place where you've been year after year because you know you like it, the place is comfortable, it has great food, we know we're going to have a good time, or do you want to discover something new and exciting and go to a place you've never been before? And I think both are valuable.
Great.
And so I think that that's the analogy that I think of when I think about, okay, we know this is the laugh. We know we're going to get this laugh. We've road tested it, and it's reliable. But isn't the thing that's always the most exciting, even for a comic like yourself, is that new piece of material, that thrill of the first time, like, wow, it works, and the discovery.
All right, so speaking to that, you started with Proops and Brakeman.
1954.
And you were a brilliant comedy team. Some of that was scripted, but I would assume a lot of that was improv.
No, we scripted everything, and then I would start going off the script, and that's when we had disagreements. And then he ended up moving to L.A. We were in San Francisco. He moved to L.A., and then I was left on my own, and so I floundered for a year, but then I joined an improv group. And so I did improv for a couple of years, and then I came back to doing stand-up. And I found that after doing the improv, I had a lot more – I didn't want to get up alone. I'd worked with a partner, and I was really afraid to, like – I didn't think I could just hold the crowd by myself. I like being in a group. I like being in a gang. And
I remember when you came back to stand-up.
Yeah.
I remember that. I
started as an opener again and the whole enchilada.
Yeah, and I remember thinking he's not – like, he's not going to be able to do it.
Right.
He doesn't have – you know, I'm certainly a couple of years ahead of him now.
Yeah.
Were you competitive back then? You were a little, right? I remember.
I was, but I don't think I was an asshole about it.
Was the San Francisco scene competitive? I think it was.
I think it was healthily. Healthily? Is that the word?
I think it's more competitive than the New York scene because I've started at the beginning again. Uh-huh. I'm at square one. I'm rewriting my act. I'm getting a divorce. I can't, you know, in my act, it used to be how much I hated my wife and my kids.
Yeah.
Because it wasn't true.
Right.
Now when I tell those jokes, it feels kind of true.
I was going to say, this is a little close to the bone now.
Yeah, so now I'm writing a new X. I'm starting at the beginning, and one of the things I'm noticing about New York is how generous the entire scene is. And if you make it, I make it.
I also think that's generational, though. I mean, I definitely felt, because I bounced back and forth in the 80s between L.A., where I grew up and where I was based, and San Francisco. And I felt like I was one of the few people who could sort of do that because sort of the San Francisco scene hated L.A. and hated all the L.A. comics. And, of course, the L.A. comics didn't know San Francisco.
Right, didn't care at all,
Right.
It was always a one-way rivalry.
It was always like the relationship between Boston and New York.
Right.
It was kind of
ooh, Boston, we hate New York. And people in New York, where's Boston?
Yeah.
Right.
Is that near Philly?
Yeah, you know, being from L.A. It's like
Maron's joke about his ex-wife who remarries, and he goes, so that's her game. Like, he's still thinking about her, and she's off having a family.
Right. But at the time, I really found the San Francisco scene to be, you know, very pure, very artistically pure. Mm-hmm. I found that the intentions of the the scene, the people in the scene in San Francisco then, when L.A., I think, was very, at that point, was very about, like, getting the Tonight Show and getting discovered.
God bless you.
Getting...
God bless you. God bless you, Dan Pasternak.
I know, right?
Say that again about the San Francisco.
No,
the intentions were pure. You had to earn your stage time. You never took the stage time for granted. And the goddamn gatekeepers in San Francisco were murderous. They were snobs, and if you didn't pass their muster, you were not going to get the stage time. I never take stage time for granted because it's gold.
Well, also, nobody at that time in San Francisco, to my knowledge, or at least to my knowledge at that point, had representation. So
only a few. Bob Fisher was one of the few managers sticking around.
Right. We had taxation, though.
Right, but no relaxation.
Yeah. That's for you young kids, that's why Greg Proops is a big star and I'm not. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah.
He is the smartest man in the world.
Or the world's smartest man, if you're a circus act.
Or dyslexic.
Yeah. No, I think you're right about that, and I think that...
Do you think it held you back? Because I think the purity... I'm being serious.
It was difficult to get into the regular world because you'd play in San Francisco, say for instance, that Wonderland that was the other cafe in the 80s, the one that was on Carlin Cole. And you'd murder for the whole weekend, and then you'd go on the road and do the same act, and they would stare at you because you were too high concept, there was too many sub-references. We were violently opposed to any hackery. And that was the biggest crime in San Francisco. If you came from the South Bay or the East Bay and you were a hack, then you got a lot of frosty attitude from all the San Francisco comics. But if you were conceptual and intelligent and played above the crowd and did your own thing, I mean...
Oh, slow down. Hang on for one second. For my benefit, because I'm not as smart as you, and you're saying something that is just in my bones. If you were conceptual and playing above the audience's IQ or appealing to their better angel, then you were celebrated in San Francisco.
Right. Earl.
Right. So, and so if you killed, if you pulled into town and killed right then and there, you were suspicious.
Especially if you got too many laughs or the audience liked you too much. The idea in San Francisco was always that the audience wasn't exactly your partner in comedy, that you were going to present them with this thing, and then they had to discern.
Well, what I found about that audience, it's interesting, because this sort of circles back, David, to what you were talking about, sort of the New York scene right now, is I felt it was a very literate comedy audience.
In San Francisco.
In the 80s. I actually feel that the New York comedy audience is just as literate.
Now.
Yeah.
And but so it wasn't in the 80s.
No. See, I wasn't here in the 80s. I was only on the West Coast in the 80s. But I really did feel that, Greg, kind of like another way to maybe say what you were saying is they appreciated authenticity more than funny.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Like somebody like Will Durst, who I'm still friends with to this day, it's like sometimes – the stuff that Durst writes is so smart and so clever, but it's not necessarily like you're going to bust a gut laughing. Right. Sometimes it is, and I think he's brilliant. Yeah. But I think that people just kind of went like, wow, he just kind of distilled that idea in the most efficient, clever
anybody who did rap songs or anybody who did too much floofery on stage or too much how you doing tonight. In the 80s, if you were a magician or a guitar act, other than like Leland Moss or the one or two venerated guitar acts in San Francisco, everybody kind of sniffed and was like, oh, I don't want to follow the juggler. I'm a wordsmith, for goodness sakes. I'm up here. My act should be printed on brass tablets and everyone should have to look at them in the town square, you know, like... I think there was a lot of that going on, and I think that was the healthy part.
Yeah, Tom Sawyer, who I think doesn't get the credit.
The Cubs.
Tom Sawyer was the San Francisco gatekeeper. I still, to this day, feel like I've never lived up to his standard.
Me neither.
You know,
he used to say things to me like, you know, you don't have to do the same jokes every time to open. And I'd be like, you know,
right.
But it's working.
Right. I mean, Tom was somebody who started when we did and then walked away from it to manage Cobb.
Thank God he walked away. He wasn't a very good comic.
I thought he was okay.
He was a brilliant...
I didn't know he started as a comic.
Oh, yeah. He was a stand-up comic.
Oh, he would... I remember...
When?
I want to get a physical.
81.
Physical.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to get a... turn your head and cough again.
Yeah.
Cough again. The other
he's
one...
a brilliant impressionist.
Yeah.
Tom Sawyer is a brilliant impressionist. Vincent Price, like really wild impressions that no one else does.
Yeah, it was very...
He'd do them for you after hours when we're sitting around.
He brought, here's the thing that he did in San Francisco. He would bring in acts from out of town who nobody had heard of yet, like Kinison.
Mm-hmm.
And this is going back to the standards. Rick Overton brought Jim Carrey into Cobb's, and Jim Carrey could not play San Francisco because all he was an impressionist. Mm-hmm.
Well, that's when he was doing his Vegas act.
Right.
Now, by
Bruce
the way,
Stern
and you know the whole story of how he essentially tore that act to the ground.
Right, he did it at Cobb's.
Well, the interesting thing is Kinison was kind of the one who shamed him out of doing that act, which was killing for him when Mitzi had that room in Vegas.
By the way, if you go back and watch Jim Carrey's impressions, it was like a Twilight Zone episode. It was like he had made a deal with the devil.
Oh, yeah, he was fantastic.
I mean, it wasn't just vocal impressions. He would do facial
Bruce Dern, my favorite one. He'd turn around like Dobby.
Or Michael Landon smiling.
Yeah, Michael Landon smiling.
It was almost creepy.
Yeah,
it was so great.
Yeah.
And then they brought him up to Cobb's. I'm not going to say Cobb's was, Tom Sawyer and Rick Overton were personally responsible for the transformation. But he wasn't allowed to play San Francisco with that Mitzi Vegas act. He had to be changed.
But I'm telling you, Kinison was the one, because Kinison could get inside your head like nobody I've ever experienced in my life. And Kinison was the one who kind of just scoffed at Carrey and went, you're just an impressionist. You're not a real comedian. And that's when Carrey threw out the act and literally went on stage with nothing and just built it from the ground up.
That's astounding. I mean, but those are the kind of standards that was in San Francisco. I mean, I worked there for a year as a house MC at Cobb's. They were the last club to headline me. I was headlining everywhere else, and he wouldn't, because he didn't think my act was up to, it's as smart as it should have been. And then when I did headline for him, he headlined me every year for a zillion years and gave me more money than any club owner. I told him a couple years ago, and he got very emotional. Like, I wrote him this big, long letter about how much he helped me and how much I appreciated that. It was, no matter what, I knew he was in my corner. You know what I mean? And that means so much when you're a comic, especially when you're young, to have someone go. I remember when he made me the house MC, he goes, I'm going to give you a week's work every month.
Wow.
And you're like, when you're an MC, you're like, what? You know? And so I played with George Wallace and, oh my God, not Jeff Stelson. I can think of a million.
Greg Travis?
80s, 80s comedians that came through San Francisco. And I hosted for all of them. And he would give these terrible lectures to every comedian about how they were failing. I never got a terrible one, but Dana Gould, I remember he sat Dana Gould down, who's a genius,
Brilliant. And
told him he wasn't living up to his potential, you know? And but I don't know that we needed it, but it was effective. Like,
I'm curious, do Tom Sawyer still exist?
That's the thing. It's like, when you go...
Alex Frizzell, maybe.
I don't know how much you go on the road, but like, when you go to comedy clubs out in America, there's no one... Tom was the owner, bottle washer, doorman. You know what I mean? Like, he was standing there. No one walked onto that stage that he didn't pass. I mean, no one. I remember when Tom Rhodes first came to San Francisco, I said, you should give this. He's really funny. And I'd already worked with him a little. So he put him up, and he came over to me while Tom was on one night. And he goes, he's all attitude. And I went, he's not. Listen to him. So he put him up a couple. Now, I'm not saying I helped Tom Rhodes' career or anything, but eventually he did start to play him there and everything. But he was rough, baby. If he didn't like your look or your first few jokes, or he thought you were pandering in any way, or I think his biggest thing was if you were playing below what he thought you could
I have do. A very vivid memory. I was killing it at the Holy City Zoo, which was for clowns. You had to be a clown. That was the other cafe was for the cerebral
type. Right. The other cafe was your eggheads.
Right. And I was a Holy City Zoo guy. I wanted, and I think that's what Robin kept in his heart, the Holy City.
Yeah,
I think he loved
very
the
much
Holy
so.
City Zoo.
Is that like Mark Wiener at the time was like kind of like a big Holy City Zoo guy? Remember Mark Wiener and the Wienerettes?
No, I don't think. I'm from Nickelodeon, but that was not a...
Wasn't he the street performer guy who...
No.
Am I getting the name wrong?
There was a Mark Wiener in the Wienerettes, but I don't think of him as a Holy City Zoo act. But I do remember this. Milt Abel and Larry Brown said to Tom, you really should see David Feldman. He's killing it at the Holy City Zoo. This was pre-Clown Zoo.
This was before Feldo.
Yeah. So I open with Sawyer's in the crowd, and I open up with Raymond Donovan. something about the Secretary of Labor and yeah. Ronald Reagan, three smart jokes. Yeah. They don't work. I panic. I go, you want to confuse your cat? Leave one of your own in his box. Big laugh. Yeah. And I, big laugh. And I see, oh, I'm getting a standing ovation from somebody. And it was the back of Tom Sawyer's
right,
head
walking.
Storming yeah, out yeah, of yeah. the club. And then he called up Milt and Larry and screamed at them. Feldman sucks. And, you know, and I've never gotten over that. Yeah. I still to this day just remember that.
That's hilarious.
Somebody, we were.
He would tell comics openly.
Yeah.
I mean, people would, they'd play cards sometimes at Cobb's afterward. And I won't say his name because he's passed, but there was a comic that would come and go, and he said to Tom one night, how come you never put me on at your club? And Tom had had a few. And Tom goes, because you're a fucking hack, and you fucking suck, and your fucking comedy is lowbrow bullshit that I don't want to put up in front of my fucking paying customers who are beloved. You know, I'm like, late. And then it got swiftly escalated to almost, you know, they had to be separated and shit. And Tom was a bulldog, man. Like, if he didn't like it and you really, really wanted to know the truth, he would tell you the truth, which no one wants to hear.
How much of the San Francisco scene was about the hang? How much?
In those days, we all hung on.
But how important was it to furthering your career?
Well, I mean, when I first started, which I think is around the same time you first started, you did open mic. I remember Milt Abel said to me in like 1983, I've hosted more showcases and I've been in more showcases than any comic in San Francisco. Like, we're talking a couple hundred nights a year.
Right. He would do like
five nights a year.
Right.
Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday. And then if you had a gig, blah, blah, blah.
I was an alcoholic. I was trying to quit alcohol, and I didn't like.
I still am, David. So this hurts a little.
And I didn't want to hang out in bars.
Yeah.
And one of the things I found refreshing about San Francisco was you were being judged solely on the 5 to 10 minutes you spent on stage. Mm-hmm. There was nothing. You couldn't glad hand. You couldn't send Christmas gifts.
No.
There was nothing you can do other than be funny.
Right.
And I struggle with this now because Alex Brazil is always saying to me, hang out with people.
I hate hanging out now. I'm way past the age of hanging out.
But it is important to hang out.
Of course it is. And people think you're being rude because you fuck off and they think you're better than them and da da da. And it's like, well, I'm married. I have stuff to do.
Right.
But in those days when you were single in your 20s, it was like, but yeah, there was no shortcuts then. I remember the first gig I ever got, Forrest and I did a set at the Zoo. Forrest Brakeman. I was in a very unfunny double act, and or team, as we called them then. And the phone,
you guys were very funny.
The phone rang downstairs, and it was Rebecca, who was sitting upstairs at the Zoo. The Zoo was the smallest club in the world, and yet they would phone from upstairs. It was literally there, right? And it was a red phone, like the bat phone.
Uh-huh.
And I don't remember who was bartending. Went, hey, come here. Becky wants to give you guys a paid set on Wednesday. And we were like, fucking, oh, my God. You know, like that. It was 1982.
Same year as me.
Yeah. And I think we got $7.50 each or something like that.
Was it Steve Pearl Presents?
Oh, yeah. Which meant Steve Pearl would go on and do an hour.
Uh-huh.
Then he would bring on the first act.
But an hour of lightning bolts from God.
Yeah, yeah,
God
yeah,
was
yeah.
speaking directly to Stephen Pearl, right?
The Spanish Three Stooges, he would do. Mo, Larry, what was it? Mo, Curly, and Lorenzo.
See, I was obsessed with Pearl.
Pearl was so funny.
Because I was from New York, and he was from New York. And you know how you own certain things?
Yeah.
Like, I owned Pearl. I was convinced that only I really got the genius of Steve Pearl.
Right.
And I would say, you don't understand how funny he is. Well, he's a genius. And you just don't get. I get all the jokes. I was very possessive.
He was so funny. Yeah. The Elvis Presley Nature Trail. Oh, here's a two and all bush. Oh, here's the second all lake. So Pearl would do an hour, and then you bring up the first act. Then he'd do another hour. Then he'd bring up the second act. Then he'd do another hour and bring up the third. So, you know, you were up there to do 15. If you ever got on at his show, which was his Wednesday night show. But everybody came through there. I mean, and it was a shithole. It really was. The bathroom was awful, and it was right there next to the. And when people had to go, they had to walk in front of the stage. If you were going to make egress or ingress to that club, you walked in front of the performers every time.
Is it safe to say that Jeremy Kramer was Robin's all-time favorite?
I would say. I think the comics that had the most influence on me were Kramer because of his absolute fearlessness on stage. There was years would go by where he, no laughs. And he stood his ground all the time, always. I remember playing a weekend with him at the other end. He turned to the window and sat and went, "Jeremy, Jeremy, nobody likes Jeremy," for like a year, right? Right. At this point, the crowd has no idea what's going on. My wife, who I was just dating then, that's how long ago it was, is in hysterics. And him, Slayton, because he was cocksure, Slayton's stage presence impressed me more than anything else because he never smiled. He just rattled the jokes off and wildly racist and misogynistic.
San Francisco.
Oh, yeah. He's the only one that was allowed to be. Mm-hmm. And I always said, "You're Lenny Bruce without a conscience." You know, like, if Lenny Bruce had been stripped of any moral barometer, you know, like, because he would do Chinese people to Chinese people. He would do black people to black people and just murderize.
Right.
And then Durst, because Durst helped me learn the craft. I remember going to a gig in some shithole in San Rafael on a Tuesday night. And I was getting $50 or something. And I presume he was getting $250. This is the 80s. And I go, "What are you doing here on a Tuesday?" And he goes, "Greg, I'm working." "I'm a comedian."
Right, mm-hmm. Right.
And he goes, "There's something to be learned every night, Greg." Right. "You don't just quit when you're..." I mean, like, "You're a headliner and you get more money than me." You know, like... And then he also said to me once, though, "What did you do with that joke? You dropped it from your act." And I went, "Well, it's not timely anymore." And he goes, "Never... ever discard jokes. You can recycle those jokes and rewrite them. The idea is still there, the kernel of it. You're throwing material away by doing that." And I'll, you know, as a 20-something, I was like, "I never thought of that." You know, so I've told him this too, which of course he hates to hear, and everyone hates to hear when you're their unintentional mentor. Mm-hmm. No one wants to be that, but I learned all that from him. The economy of writing, the keeping the writing. The writing has to be in a book and you have to go back to it, and you can take a joke from 20 years ago and redo it. There's always a stupid politician, whether right. it was Reagan, whether it was W, whether it was Trump. I mean, you know, like, I'm not saying I'm using recycled Reagan jokes with Trump, but I'm saying the idea of keeping that.
Uh-oh.
Hey.
Hi. Here's the deal.
What?
Hi!
Jingle, how are you, darling?
God, I haven't seen you in forever. Oh, I love you.
What's going on here?
It's so nice to be with a real man. Yeah. You know?
What's going on? My wife is...
So pro my, women and just smart. So smart and
honey,
really talented.
You know my wife, yeah, Judy Gold. Judy, you want to sit down?
Sit down,
darling. I'm, you goddamn son of a bitch!
What, honey, not, can you just
Hi.
Wait? Have a seat.
How are you,
Judy? How are you?
Can you just sit? And
yeah, I can sit.
Do you mind?
Oh, there's wine?
My wife yeah. doesn't... She doesn't...
Really?
There was wine.
Are these great people?
I don't know who they are. I don't know where we are, in fact.
So,
I just wandered into a flat.
So,
is this where you live, Alex?
So Will Durst said to me that it...
Name dropping.
That it takes 4 years to get funny.
No, more.
Well, was that Will Durst or Robert Durst who said that?
Good one. Yeah.
Thank you.
3 years to find the body.
And 40 years to admit that you yeah. just fucking yeah. murdered 85 people.
Yeah, after a yeah. good set, you go to the yeah. bathroom and go, I killed them. Yeah. Yeah.
Judy Gold has just joined us.
I just joined you guys.
How are you, madame?
You know, I'm in rehearsals for Shakespeare in the Park. And
nice. What are you playing?
Well, we're doing an all-female version of Taming of the Shrew.
Fantastic.
I don't know if you guys have heard of it.
Yes. Yeah.
And I'm playing Gremio. I'm playing a man. Mm-hmm. So we have had
You're
movement.
Patricio's sidekick?
I am Baptista's sidekick.
Baptista's.
Yes. I am the very wealthy, older gentleman who wants Bianca, but... gets tricked out of every, and so we have to. We have been learning how to walk like men, all the things these things men do, and the women who are straight. I happen to be a lesbian, and it was right after I fucked David Feldman.
Yeah,
I'm a carrier.
That would
do
it.
That joke: a vegetarian's last hot dog.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, Greg.
It's not my joke. I forget who used to do it.
A lot of the women who are straight are having problems with their husbands right. and partners because they're, like, noticing all the shit they do. Mm-hmm. So they're not, you know, when they don't want to listen or... Yeah.
What have you learned from learning to be a man?
That you, David Feldman, are probably a woman.
Okay.
That you probably have some sort of vaginal, a uterus or somewhere, hidden cervix.
Well, we've had sex. Why don't you describe what you encountered? What was down there? Tell them.
The best part was putting my fingers through your hair.
Uh-huh.
The one?
What, that one, yeah. That one right there.
Every plug has been bought and paid for.
What was it like?
What was it like down there? Because you explored my below my belt. What? Tell them. Describe it.
You know those people on the beach with those things?
The metal detectors?
Metal detectors. Mm-hmm. Let's just say I could have used a penis detector.
All right.
Ugh. I can't believe anyone has had sex. Do you make nasty, sarcastic comments when you're having sex?
No, I just have my eye on the meter.
Okay, Greg, I'm going to give... This is, my mother passed away last June.
I'm sorry.
Thank you.
My condolences.
Thank you, Greg. Thank you.
I'm happy about
thank
it.
You. And I...
I was thrilled.
This is what
she's,
the text...
She's still in your act, though, right?
Yes. Okay. And this is... Well,
So she lives on.
Right, absolutely. And I get a text. You know, everyone's like, oh, I'm so sorry, blah, blah. And I get a text from David Feldman that says, can you pick me up from the airport? And then I don't answer, and it's like, question mark, question mark, question mark, question mark.
And then she writes, I'm sitting Shiva.
Yeah.
And I said, what time does it end? Because my flight comes in.
Oh, yes.
And if you wouldn't mind, you know, I'm hungry.
Yeah.
You've got to respect him doubling down on it.
Yeah, that's true. Right, yeah. That's true.
If you could bring a Bialy or something.
Right. Now, has Alex heard of any sort of air conditioning or... the fan moving at, you know, point...
Yeah.
Let's... Now
ready for a Rickles joke. There's a guy in the back going, hey, you, buddy.
Why is everyone else drinking?
All right.
Elise, are you having any?
Enough talk about comedy. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about...
All right.
Tragedy.
We just talked about you.
Enough of your act, David.
How long is this going? Because, you know, I'm recording a podcast here with Mr. Proops.
Are you?
Yes, I am.
Okay, well, let's...
Are we?
Yes!
It's podcast ambush. Let's
it
talk...
It is. I'm getting ambushed in
all right,
podcast.
I'm going to make a statement, and then you guys respond. First of all, let's... Dan Pasternack.
You mean refute.
Okay.
yes, Dan
Daniel.
Tell us why Judy Gold is...
Daniel, you're very nice.
Thanks.
Tell us why Judy Gold is one of the funniest people who's ever held a microphone.
She's Jewish.
Thank you. And the sisterhood will be meeting at 7 p.m. Sunday night for... All right, go ahead.
No, she knows who she is, you know. I think comedy is the great practitioners are people who know who they are and own it. And I think that's what you've always...
And this
Dan,
is this
you.
Is not a joke.
Thank you, Dan.
This is not a joke. His wife is
sorry.
Here.
My wife is here.
Right?
Not yet. We're not wives yet.
No. Do you want... I have to drink.
Are you a psychologist?
Yeah, the worst combination. Like, I hate myself already, you know? And I'm already thinking, oh, I'm fucked. You know, like, I wake up like, you're an asshole, you're an asshole, you're an asshole, you're an asshole. You didn't finish that New Yorker article, you're an asshole, you're stupid, you think you're smart. You know, and then someone else just berating, you know, 800 questions. Well, why do you think you did that? Because I'm an asshole. I'm an asshole.
Trump. Have you heard of him?
Are we changing topics?
Yes,
apparently.
That was very
no,
deft.
No, we went right from asshole to Trump. It's
oh,
seamless.
I see.
What I was going to say.
I was just fixating on what Judy was saying because I feel the same way. I wake up in the morning and I'm like, what the fuck did I do? You know what I mean? Why did it happen this
right,
way?
Right, right.
In 1992, I could have done this and everything would have been different.
Right, right,
that's
right.
All I can think about. And
then I go, I wonder the years that go by.
Right, right, decades.
I'm like, wait, what did I do? Yeah. Was I happy then? Wait, I thought I was fat then, and I'm not. I'm fat now. You know, it's like
right.
That you look in the mirror, and you're like, no fucking way.
Right. Well, Fran Lebowitz had a line where she goes, when you're 40, you take a picture of yourself, and you're like, oh, I didn't like that picture. And then she goes, the older you get, the better that picture
right,
is
right.
When you were 40.
Right.
And then I find myself looking at pictures of myself when I was in my 40s and right. Going, ooh, that was good.
Right.
God damn it. I don't think anyone's funnier than Fran Lebowitz. Right. She gets no credit, but she's not a stand-up comic, but she's genius.
She is fucking hilarious. Genius.
What did she say the one the other day?
She's so
you see 40-year-old men on skateboards. She goes, you don't see 40-year-old women on skateboards because women grow up.
I love that.
Yes, Trump.
What I was going to say is that Judy owns it and Trump owns it, and that's what's so appealing. And
oh yeah,
hang on.
Oh, okay, I see what
deep,
you're doing.
Deep down inside, on if I held a gun to your head,
yes,
and after my erection subsided, right, I'm holding a gun to your head.
I was going to say, I remember when we shot this movie in the early '80s, Hung Men of the Night, I think yes. It was called.
Don't it was on you, HBO.
Yeah.
Don't, isn't there a huge part, a huge part?
Huge.
Huge.
That loves Trump.
Of me?
Yes.
No, but I would rather have dinner with him than Ted Cruz. If you're going to have dinner with Trump, there'd be stories. He'd tell you weird shit. There'd be secrets. He'd say something horrible. Uh-huh. Ted Cruz, I think he'd be sanctimonious.
I would probably not want the Trump steak. That's the only thing I would say. I would have that dinner, but just...
Did you see in the Times today, they interviewed over 50 women who have, dealt with him.
How bad was he?
He was really bad. Any woman who votes for him...
Is he a rapist? Did he force himself?
I didn't read the whole article.
But that would be the headline.
Not like she didn't skip down to the rape
part. All I have to say is the person who is happiest for Trump's success is Bill Cosby. That's all I have to say.
Here's the conversation my wife and I were literally having on the train. I'm just going to caucus the three of you here. Do you think that there is any transgression, any revelation that could come out about Trump that would change the minds of the people who are inclined already to vote for him?
No.
That he would say something that is horrifying.
No.
Something would be revealed about him in business or in his personal life. Is there anything that we could unearth about Trump where he'd go, wow, gosh, now that I know that about Trump, I don't think I could vote for him. Right?
Absolutely
that's,
not.
That's the genius of Trump as the candidate. Right,
right, right. Right. He's a maverick, even though he's a rich, failed billionaire, serial idiot, whatever you want to call
him. He's a billionaire who's not a billionaire.
He's a failed millionaire, kind of vituperative, misogynistic snake,
But the more hateful things he says...
Right, he plays to the grandstand.
Right. And it seems that, that is a huge base that has largely gone unserved.
Well, yes, these are the people, the white men who are having temper tantrums and, laying on farms in Oregon with their fucking guns. They're like, no one's representing me. And now they have the biggest fucking piece of shit, asshole, misogynistic, fucking liar, crap ass fuck head.
Isn't it too?
By the way, that should be his slogan.
Make America.
I'm Donald Trump, and I approve this message.
I read this thing. No journalists have asked him what when you say "Make America Great," what do you mean? What era are you talking about?
The segregation era, the homophobic era, slavery, the Confederacy. Which era was America great in that he's talking about? A fictional white people past that they keep fobbing off on all of us. The anyone can succeed if they work hard enough trope that's the most inane piece of bullshit that's ever been funneled down the world. And then the idea that keeping Muslims out of the country is going to make America great. The future is an all-inclusive future where everyone gets recognized, and he's not having that. And I think that's what the people respond to that love him. And therefore, nothing he did. If he abused women, I would have too. I was rich. I had money. You know what I mean?
I've known you since 1982.
Yeah.
You know me better than anybody in this room.
Probably.
You've and seen me at my worst points, like now.
Wow.
Why? So.
It's worse than this?
No, it's never been worse than this.
All right. Yeah, this is bad.
Why do I love Trump?
Love Trump?
Yes, I do.
Well, I think because he...
What's wrong with me?
You're a contrarian by nature, and he appeals...
Yes, I am. Yes, I am.
He appeals to that element of your personality. Anyone who would ask for a ride from someone whose mother's just died is going to love Trump as part of their sense of humor, I think.
But I also believe he's doing a great service to this country.
I do, too. He's imploding the Republican Party possibly for 16 years.
What
at
else?
Least
but
eight.
Don't you think the Republican Party, I mean, sort of, I felt like with the emergence of the Tea Party, it's like, oh, God, there's not one Republican Party anymore, right? Yeah.
I so, see. I don't buy into.
Yeah,
I,
but look what Bernie Sanders is doing to the Democratic Party.
I think the GOP is like NBC in that.
Ann Curry.
Yeah. the GOP is like NBC in that. You get a programming director in there who puts on Super Train and Hello Larry and Pink Lady and Jeff.
Okay,
and they
if you're going to just do the whole Fred Silverman thing, I don't want to replay that episode.
All right, so it's like Fred Silverman. They go, NBC is ruined forever. Yeah. And then Ronald Reagan comes in as the program director of NBC, and it's morning again. So I think in 4 years.
So in your scenario, Ronald Reagan was the Brandon Tartikoff at the Republican
right.
Party.
The Grand Tinker. The Grand Tinker.
Oh, okay.
Grand
wow.
Tinker.
Got it.
What
got
I'm
it.
Saying is that, and I mean this, that...
That's an analogy by that yeah. four people.
I know.
That Trump We're is old. Fred Silverman. He's destroying the network, but it's still an institution, and overnight you can reprogram it.
Oh, sure. And does he even want to be president? Let's get to the bottom line on this. He can't really be president. And if he was, what would he do?
And what the fuck? What are other people going to... He's going to talk to other leaders of other countries?
Right?
What
especially Muslim leaders.
I know.
After saying I hate Muslims
What about
Muslims
the mayor of London?
Yeah.
He didn't say he hates... First of all, he didn't say he hates Muslims. He said we have to stop new Muslims from coming in till we figure out what's going on. And I think that's a fair statement.
Oh, my God.
He doesn't understand what's going on. That's right. Honest. That's a... Okay?
Well, I think Melania will make a wonderful first lady. I mean, she is brilliant.
Right, welcome Melania. To the White House.
I have
welcome to the White House.
Would you like some tea?
Isn't actual definition of the word Melania a cancer you will die from? Isn't
that's that? Melanoma.
Okay, sorry.
But we can call her Melanoma.
I confuse those two all the time.
Melanomia. That's his. That's his wife's name. Melanomia.
Do you,
I love Donald.
Is it
so
possible
powerful.
That I love this country more than everybody in this room combined?
Oh, to be sure, David. Yeah. Your patriotism has never been in question.
And I believe that...
That's why you left the West Coast.
Yeah.
I believe that
this... That and his clinical depression.
Yeah.
Melania.
That's
Melanomia.
Textbook depression, by the way.
Okay,
I'm
yes.
in books.
Okay.
My depression
fantastic.
Is
Donald
renowned.
Is a wonderful man.
Yeah, your depression went from 1929 to 1940.
I maintain that this country is so great and so strong and the system works that not one man can destroy this country. That
no,
Trump
probably not.
And that,
W didn't and he tried, you know.
Right. And Hitler.
The difference between Trump and Hitler is Hitler had a plan.
Right.
No, the difference Hitler between Trump and Hitler...
Hitler didn't wing it.
Hitler had taste when it came to architecture.
Well, I mean, but he didn't just go, we're going to... About the Jews until we figure something out.
Yeah,
he
right.
didn't say shit
between,
like that.
The
know?
Difference between Trump and Hitler is I think that Hitler actually had substance. It was horrible substance, yeah. but there was actual substance there. Trump has no substance. What he has is great branding. Yeah. That's what he
well,
does.
This is a fucking reality show. Yeah. He calls yes. the other right. people competitors. They were great
right.
competitors.
Right.
We're not on The Fucking Apprentice, you asshole. Mm. I
by
hate
the,
him.
By the way, that is how he's going to pick his VP.
I know.
You watch.
Right.
And we're in the home stretch after.
I just can't believe Elizabeth Warren is just like, go fuck yourself on yeah. Twitter. And like, no one else is doing that to him.
But don't you think, because I got into
you
this.
Mean Goofy Elizabeth?
Yeah, Goofy Elizabeth.
Hey,
he's so attractive
hey.
Too.
she's,
and no one
she's
talks
a Native
about
American,
his fucking
right? hey,
pancake
how are you?
Head.
Hey.
Fucking
hey,
yeah.
God. You. This is what I maintain, and no offense, but you know, you talk about scapegoating, but you say Trump is scapegoating people. I think you're scapegoating Trump. I think you need somebody to hate, and Americans.
I have you, David.
All right.
I mean, it's fucking amazing.
Trump never asked for a ride.
Okay.
Yeah.
Feldman's hair or Trump's hair? Pick one.
I'm going to have to go with Feldman's hair.
Okay.
Because he
you.
Paid so much fucking money for it. And he opened for me at Caroline's with a fucking baseball cap on. He spent how much money on that fucking hair? And then he's like, comes on stage. He looks like a big fucking slob. It's Christmas Eve. He's got a fucking... He's like, oh, my manager said I need to wear baseball caps so I can look young and hip.
You mean like never, Michael Malley?
Yeah.
That young and hip?
Yeah. Young and broken hip is what you are.
No, I didn't want to show too much respect for the audience. That's
wow.
Wow, that's
by
great.
Dressing
wow.
up for them.
Wow.
You're supposed so don't you wake up every morning wanting you talk about waking up and say I regret, I should have done this, what
it's
happened?
It's just like what and, happened at the time.
And then you so you say it's Trump's fault. This is what you turn
no,
on the
no, I don't
saying,
say that
you're
actually.
Scapegoating Donald Trump.
I don't blame Trump for my right. My shortcomings.
But you need to be angry at somebody, so you vent.
I'm always been way more angry at Dick Cheney than I could
yes,
ever be at Trump.
Yes, that is true. I fucking hate that
I will
piece
never
of shit.
Forgive Bush and Cheney for what they did. I think they destroyed the country. I think they set the world into a terrible spin, and I think we're barely recovering from that after
well,
8 years.
Well, those people from that era who were not educated are the ones voting for Trump.
Yeah.
The fucking Bush. Dick Cheney, whenever someone dies, I'm like, I can't fucking believe they're dead. And Dick fucking fake heart Cheney
let's get
is
back.
Alive.
Because he said he was supporting Trump the other day. W even had the decency to say, I'm not involved in this.
Right.
And Cheney, he's fine. You know, the dark-skinned people, they come around
yeah.
and pile up
well,
money on
it
them.
Takes a dick to fucking support
right?
Donald Trump.
I mean, I think asshole. They did more damage to the country than any president
yeah,
in my lifetime.
I agree.
I hated Reagan and I hated Herbert Walker, but Bush and Cheney really put the zang on everything. And just the inhumanity of Katrina and all those things.
Oh, I know.
The unbelievable
and
inhumanity.
And no one fucking... Can you be a black Republican after
right.
that Katrina
right.
shit?
Right. Well, how can back? You be a woman and vote for Trump?
I know.
You know what I mean?
And they're standing behind him.
Yeah.
Fucking asshole.
Read Iceberg Slim and then you'll understand why women vote for Trump.
I don't have time.
Okay.
Iceberg Slim? I didn't put it there.
All right. Bernie Sanders.
Not my favorite. I mean, I'm glad he's in the race.
I
think
Greg.
He's fun, and but I don't. I said it before,
and you'll say it again.
I will right now. Joe Klein in Time Magazine said it, and it's true. Every Jew has an Uncle Bernie. I think that the people who are so
I
excited,
have an Uncle Bernie.
Every all the young people who are excited about him, that all the white millennial, you know, fixed brake bike wearing fucking rescue dog named Cobain, drinking fucking
knit cap,
locally
in 100-degree weather,
yeah.
tattoo.
They think he's
yeah.
fun and exciting because he yells and spits and shit.
But again, you know what it is? It's authenticity. It's really interesting. Is that this is the year where whether it's the illusion of authenticity
yes.
with someone like Trump, or I think the actual authenticity of somebody, that's what people are responding
okay, I
to.
Just want
to
say,
I see misplaced misogyny from both of them.
I believe
from Bernie?
Yes.
Oh, fuck yeah.
Oh, come on.
Big time.
The
oh, well, hey,
is
hey,
fucking waving his finger
yeah,
while she's talking.
Time.
Oh, wait.
Like, yeah. Bernie,
wait.
They're not going to anyone else. You're the only one fucking there. So stop waving your finger. And it's Jane.
I totally
it's
get it.
It's Jane
that.
Sanders,
yeah.
who hates Hillary,
yeah.
that is pushing him to continue on. I guarantee you.
You think Bernie...
I agree with Judy Gold.
You God think...
Damn it, Greg!
You think that when Bernie doesn't like... Hillary, it's misogyny when he stands up to her?
He
stands up? How is he standing up? He's not a Democrat who's taking money from the Democratic
right.
Party, who's always suing the Democratic Party. Every time he loses, he complains that it wasn't his fault,
right.
that not enough people came out. And then if Hillary wins a state, oh, yeah, well, there was a lot of Schwartzes in that state, so why should we care or whatever?
Right.
He
how
puts down
misogyny?
Women consistently. He puts
does?
Down minorities consistently.
Yes, he does.
In my point of view.
What
he
about
does?
When he said it's because poor people can't,
yeah.
can't vote?
Yeah.
Oh, so every poor person is voting for
you're
you?
You're too stupid not to vote for him in
right.
his estimation. And that just drives me mad.
And also what's
taking
his foreign
tons
policy?
Of money. So
yeah.
he's committing what we would call a fraudulent act by carrying on, taking money
God,
in a Pyrrhic campaign that he can't possibly win.
I love Greg Proops.
Well,
I love him.
I mean, I he has every right to run, and I think it's exciting because it's galvanized young people who have no idea how the political system works because our educational system has let everyone down so horribly, utterly, and completely. I voted the minute I was 18, and I voted for Jimmy Carter, because that's the kind of Don Quixote.
Yeah. He's really good for Israel, by
yeah,
the way. Cheers.
I am. But when people in New York complain, like, oh, my God, I can't believe that you can't vote for someone if you didn't register ahead for the party. It's like, we've had this for 1,000 years,
right.
you guys. Wake up. Like,
right.
Fucking, that's how California is, too. In the general election, you can vote for who you like. In the primaries, you have to vote for who you registered
right.
as. It's not like a big complicated theorem that got fucking laid down
right.
on Bernie voters to suppress
them. And why do we have that? Because an example of that would be Rush Limbaugh in 2008 telling Republicans in Texas to vote for Hillary to throw the convention. In other words, you register because if I were allowed to vote, I would vote for Trump because I want to destroy the Republican Party.
Right.
So that's why that happens. I just wanted to bring this down to a...
Wow, you've really taken the low key.
It's an entertaining podcast.
When you ask me about Bernie, and I've never given my real opinion on any... On my podcast, I don't talk about it. On my podcast, it's all peace and love, and I accept all points of view and stuff. But since you ask, that's how I feel about him.
I agree with Greg Proops.
He's a channel for the misogyny that young guys feel toward women. I think guys in their 20s and early 30s. And I know I'm generalizing here, but this is what we do. They feel frustrated the way that we keep characterizing middle-aged white guys who hunt ducks or whatever feel frustrated. And I think that he's their key to, for them, he's all new and shit like that. He's been in the Senate for 100 years. If he was going to do anything substantive, he would have done it. And I'll go one step further.
Amen.
No one's ever listened to him, liked him, or paid attention to him in his entire life until the last year.
Right.
And that's why he won't fucking sit down. Because now all of a sudden everyone listens to everything he fucking
says.
And
don't be a Democrat if you're going to fuck over the Democratic
right.
Party.
Don't destroy the Democratic
Party.
You know
you can't win. And you were never a Democrat. You right. no, said he was an, shit but about that's, Democrats.
But that's... That's all coming back to the thing that I said originally, which is...
Oh, Dan. You're going to have to be nice to him tonight. Okay.
Which is, Trump is not a Republican, has never been a Republican.
Right. Never.
And Bernie has always been an independent.
Right.
So it seems that what the electorate is saying is, what we don't want are these two parties.
Right.
They're also saying what we don't want is a woman, and that's a very big
Now,
element.
Let me say something. This is my one question. If Hillary was a man and Bernie was a woman, and Bernie – and it was a Jewish woman who was a socialist.
I would tell him to smile.
Okay. It was a Jewish
– And stop baring his lower teeth all the time.
And dial it back. Don't,
okay. So a Jewish woman socialist.
Right. With dandruff and bad hair.
Right.
Who hunches.
And it's
you
talks
just described
like this,
every third woman in my
like
family.
This, and it's like, you know what, you people? You got to get rid of the banks. They're screwing everything up. And let me tell you something. The minimum wage should be higher. And we, this is ridiculous. Okay.
Bella Abzug. Bella Abzug.
Right. Now, all right.
I love Bella Abzug.
Was, well put together guy who's sort of a moderate, but a Democrat, but really very educated. There'd be no fucking contest.
Not at all.
Okay.
Well, but are men entitled to a certain aesthetic when it comes to female politicians?
No.
They're not entitled to, but they do constantly. If a woman looked as dreary as Bernie does and wore those awful fucking glasses.
What about his fucking hair?
Right.
And dandruff?
And
I
this?
Deal
and
with that. And
he would be pilloried.
Iron your
he'd
fucking shirt.
A woman.
Am I a misogynist?
And those faces he makes, Carey, yes.
Let me ask the question.
You don't have to give an example, David.
Stop there. Let's
you
move on.
You do not have to give an example. It's like the preamble to the Constitution. We hold these truths to be self-evident.
I'm going to correct the smartest man in the world.
It was the Declaration of Independence.
He's never read the Constitution.
Me?
He knows nothing about politics. No, Donald fucking asshole, piece of shit, Nazi fucking lying Trump.
Let me,
as he's known to his intimates.
Yeah.
Does it make you a misogynist if you're threatened?
You rephrased it. Now you're putting it on us.
Doesn't make
this
you a misogynist?
This is a personal pronoun exercise here, David.
Okay. Am I a misogynist?
Yes.
Yes.
Because I don't want Hillary to get elected because she's a woman.
Yes, that's what misogyny is.
What the fuck kind of question is that? What the fuck kind of question?
I'm just trying.
Here's the other thing that about
what the fuck? What is that?
All right. Does do I? Am I a misogynist?
Yes.
If I'm...
I would not pick him up at the airport if
please.
I were...
Oh, please. Get fucking dropped dead at the fucking...
Am I a misogynist if I'm threatened by smart, intelligent women who I believe should be kept in a cage in my basement? Does that make me a misogynist?
No, it makes you a pervert. Like you're, it makes you the Stieg Larsson.
No, it makes you Buffalo Bill. Yeah. It puts the lotion on its skin.
The other thing that I really... about Bernie and Trump is... I think that this should be a grand march to another step into the future by electing the most qualified candidate in my lifetime, Hillary Clinton, and that I don't see Bernie Sanders as a big bonus. Isn't it so wonderful that he threw his hat in the ring? I see him as a stumbling block in the way of what I perceive as the best possible future. I think he repeats the same thing over and over again. I don't think he has nothing new to add to the conversation. When you ask him about how you're going to you saw the interview in the Daily News, right, where they go, okay,
oh, yeah.
So you're going to redo the banks. How are you going to do it? Under whose authority? And he went, authority! I got authority! And it was like, that's not an answer.
I'm going to check with my rabbi. Oh, I'm not Jewish. Right, I'm not going to check with my rabbi.
He's a Jew, moved to Vermont. So right away.
Yeah.
Right away, I'm off that fucking train. But, I mean, like, she gets pilloried because, oh, she's so boring or she's inauthentic or she's not likable. Bernie and Trump are the least likable people I've ever fucking seen run for president. I don't understand. To me, she seems very likable. I've seen her speak live. She's engaging. She's cute. She's smart as the Dickens. If she was a man, there would be no fucking question. If a man had been first lady, if a man had been senator,
but again, wait. It's not about likability or not. Trump and Bernie are not likable.
No.
Again, I maintain, what is the quality? You know, George W. Bush, well, he just seems like a guy you'd like to have a beer with.
Right.
I'm telling you, it's about actual or perceived authenticity.
No, and I
don't want to have a beer with fucking George Bush.
Because it would be a non-alcoholic beer.
I was going to say, yeah,
he's a bore.
All right. Maybe in the 80s it would have been fun to have a beer with him, because then you'd have done a rail.
And some coke.
Yeah, I was going to say, then there would have been coke.
And then we could have been good coke because he's a rich guy. Kill someone.
Let me ask you this question.
He was rich, so you know he had good coke.
Yeah. There is much...
Delivered by a Portuguese guy with an anvil case.
Right.
Oh, no, I'll have the big package over there. That one over there. That one looks good.
I'm voting for Bernie.
What a surprise.
That is such a really good vote.
I'm registered in California as a sex offender.
Well, then you should be voting for Trump.
It's not that he's a sex offender. He has offended the act of sex. That's...
All right. This is why I'm voting for... And then you respond to this. I believe there's much virtue in going apeshit. That... You just need to pick the right target to go apeshit on. Cheney and Bush went apeshit on Iraq.
Mm.
Now, if I hated the Iraqi people, which I don't.
Only the women, right?
Only, well. If I hated the Iraqi people, I'd be very happy with what Bush and Cheney did, because they went apeshit on Iraq, and look what's happening. And what I hate is Wall Street. I hate Wall Street. And I think somebody needs to go apeshit on Wall
He's
Street.
He's not going to. Well, even if he was president, he couldn't.
Well, I think...
Why don't you wait for Elizabeth Warren to run?
Right.
Because she will actually go apeshit
on Wall Street. She might have actually read a book or have a plan or something. Know what Glass-Steagall is.
But this is why George W. Bush was stupid. And he surrounded himself with people who knew how to go apeshit.
Mm-hmm.
And I think if Bernie Sanders is stupid, at least he's pounding his chest and saying, go ape shit on these people, and he can bring in people who will destroy Wall Street the same way we destroyed Iraq.
That's great.
We need to go.
What about our standing in the world, okay? What about our standing in the world with foreign leaders?
Hillary is just, look.
Yeah, she's not qualified.
I'm going to hold. You know who's qualified?
Okay.
Her husband.
You're certainly struggling on this one. You mean
the
governor of Arkansas is more qualified than a woman?
Let me just say something.
To me,
had all of their resumes on your fucking desk, okay, and didn't know male, female, black, white, green, orange, who the fuck would you pick for president?
I would pick somebody who's new.
I said which resume?
I don't hire based on resume. I hire based on sexual orientation. which is legal in 30 states in America, by the way. Did you know, Judy Gold, that in 30 states in this country, I can say what is your sexual orientation?
Yes, and not rent me your apartment?
And or hire you because I don't approve
of... I know that because you know why?
Why?
I'm a lesbian.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
So I think...
The fight is not over, people.
I want to go ape shit on the people who ruined this economy.
Okay, that's great, and you can do that, but still elect a president who is really smart and overly qualified.
How do you know she's not going to? I mean, that's the other thing. It's like...
Because she didn't go ape shit on Bill.
Shut the fuck up.
No, that's just... Oh, God.
They have an arrangement.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. No, it's okay. I mean, I just don't... I don't see everybody's trepidation about her all the time. It doesn't read with me at all. But
it's
a
safe bet. She's a safe bet.
How?
How is she safe?
She's the boldest fucking choice we can make for the future is to make an intelligent woman like that president. Hopefully she'll pick a woman running mate, and then hopefully she'll be president for 8 years, and then her running mate will be president for eight years after that. That's my fervent fucking wish, more than anything. When Elisa breaks up with me,
I'm turning straight for Greg Proops.
Have you ever dealt with lawyers?
No,
oh, yeah,
never.
Sure.
What are you? Yes.
Okay, and they have great.
Man, I'm sorry that you have to sit through his bullshit.
They have great resumes, lawyers. Right? Lawyers have great resumes, and they.
We're not talking about that. I'm talking about fucking first lady.
You're telling me,
senator, secretary of state,
a madam and a secretary. She's had two jobs.
Wow.
I just shoehorned a bit from my act that doesn't work.
Have you heard your act, David?
How do you think it just went now?
Not good. I'm beginning to understand why.
David, have you heard your act recently?
Here's one from my act. Bernie says he's going to close the banks. No Jews ever said that. even Jesus just flipped some tables over and went, all right, fellas, we'll see you tomorrow.
That's a joke, David. Uh-huh. See, that's a joke. That's how you write a joke.
All right.
With your baseball fucking cap on.
Someone just came from the writer's room.
Yeah. It wasn't even clean. It had like the sweat salt on the side.
Just tell me it was a Mets cap and not a Boston cap. Just please.
It was like some football. It was an Oakland A's cap.
Oakland A's. So there you are.
With sweat.
A Boston
with
cap
that,
to me is like boo.
You know the white salt stains
that you get from sweating?
That was attractive as well.
I'm surprised you know that.
Campus assault artist.
Pray for me.
Yeah. I will.
This is good, this wine tonight. You know,
can we? I just want. What you're saying, and then we'll move on.
How long is this? Because I have to meet my wife at a certain point.
Wait, you have to do my podcast.
I can't. I have to. I'd meet her.
What time is it?
5:20.
And what time are we wrapping up, Alex?
5:20.
Oh. Well, it's 5:18, so you have two minutes.
We have 2 minutes. Okay. This has just been the highlight of
my trip to New York, yes.
You're at Caroline's.
Is it better than it was? I haven't played there in a couple of years.
When you're there, it's better.
Mm-hmm. You know what? People come to see you Thursday.
Well, we hope. Friday night late and Saturday night late. I've never had more fights with audiences than any club in the world.
I can't say this because we're promoting the show
and it's going to drop and then Lewis is going to hear it. He's going to listen to a podcast about politics. When Schwarzenegger...
He put fucking fake balls on his dog.
Yeah.
He put fake testicles because he's like, I couldn't have him walking around like that.
That's true.
There's people who are dying of, you know, homelessness and hunger. And he put fake balls on his fucking dog because he couldn't look... I can't have him walking around like that.
Wow.
Okay? Go.
Well, years ago, when Schwarzenegger did the beer hall putsch in California, I remember I opened with a line and I said, it's nice to have a serial rapist as our governor or whatever. And a guy in the front row at Caroline's went, no. And I went, I'm sorry. And he went, no. And I'm like, you actually don't get to stop me from doing this. And then in order to flummox him completely, I said, let's do something that's no one done in quite a while. Let's agree to disagree. And I kneeled down on the stage and went like this. Will you agree to disagree with me? And he took my hand, and he had to at that point. I shamed him into shaking hands with me. The set veered completely off the table at that point. It broke into different clacks in the house, right? So the crowd was actually heckling each other, not me, during the show. And I was talking about politics and shit. It all spun completely out of control. At the end of the show, finally, he gets up to walk because he can't take it anymore because I'm too liberal for him. And he got up and fucked off. People were screaming at the guy. And then other people were getting up and yelling. I finished the show and I was shaking. Right. I went backstage and Steven, what's his name? Kenny comes back and goes.
Oh, I love Kenny.
Yeah, I love Kenny. Kenny comes back and goes, there's a couple of people out here who want to talk to you. And I thought, oh, fuck, I'm not going out there.
Right.
There was 80 people in line that wanted to talk to me. They weren't angry with me. They'd never been to a comedy show like this before where the fucking roof came off because I wouldn't back down. And the right. conservative people in the room, this was during the Bush, you know, administration,
right.
when you weren't allowed to say a fucking thing about
right,
Bush.
Right, right, right.
America was so great and all this shit. And I've never forgotten that. I came home and Jennifer was like, what the fuck's the matter with you? I'm like, if you'd been at the show tonight, it was a fucking Donnybrook. Like, I've
right.
never seen... This was like the Republican National Convention when they nominated fucking, you know, when Roosevelt didn't get the nomination
right.
and he broke off. You know, like, it was crazy. And so my memories every time of late night shows there. And one time I'm up on stage and I barely had their attention. I'm getting toward the end and a guy in the front row is wearing a Jets jersey. He's got a shaved head. He had a body like a raindrop, right? Like a pointed head and this round body, right? And I'm finishing and he goes, I got a question. That was his voice.
Right.
And I said, yes, darling, at long last, finally.
Yes.
What is your question? And he went, how come you don't talk more about pussy? And I said, I've had more pussy than you've had hot meals. Okay. But all I could think of was, we were 40 minutes into it. 40 minutes into it, and that's all that was on his mind. And so that's why I wanted to know if the
yeah.
crowds got a little, like you were saying, crowds in New York are hipper. And I found everywhere I've gone, Oklahoma,
well, it depends
Texas.
On where you are in the city. Because
right.
honestly,
that's Times Square.
Yeah, that's Times Square. So
it's brought Caroline's on Broadway. Yeah. Broadway.
Right.
How great you are.
See, Thursday always fucks me up because, you know, you have a great, you have a good set on the weekday. Then Friday night late comes. And after 10 minutes, everyone starts talking. And I'm like, really? I can't hold your attention? I'm not talking about the biggest thing in the world.
I tell them to shut
there.
The fuck up.
Oh, I'm gonna, but like...
Yeah, just tell them to go
shut
the fuck
up. I get the agita real bad at that room sometimes. Yeah.
So, May 21st.
So come and see me the 19th through the 21st at Caroline's. I'm sure it'll be terrific this time. But I can remember so many times.
But
just,
you have,
I know, but you have
opening,
an audience. You have
opening
a built-in
for Greg
audience.
Will
it's
be
much better.
Loose dog's fake balls.
He brings the fucking dog to the office. I'm not kidding.
I think it'll be better because I think people are a little hipper. I think everyone's gotten a little hipper.
When you play Oklahoma, where do you play in Oklahoma?
Well, I just did a performance lab thing, so they were all there to see me. But I play all over the country, and I played Houston this year and Arlington, and you know, and
Arlington's great.
Yeah, and they, you know, they laugh.
Houston's
they're,
not bad.
They're
I
not
thought I was going to get killed.
It's then. Not like it was. Like the rednecks
okay,
don't go crazy and start
best
screaming.
Best rooms right now in the country.
I have to say, the Comedy Attic.
In
Bloomington,
Indiana.
Is
fantastic.
Fucking amazing.
I love that.
And my son goes to school there, so I just booked there.
Incredible, right?
And I was like, oh my God, this guy loves stand-up. He loves, it's a pure
stand-up. Can I tell you the thing that he said to
fucking
me?
Fucking best club.
I went there for their Limestone Festival 2 years ago,
yeah.
and he said a thing that honestly made me want to cry from joy. He said, I open this room so that 1 week a year I can have Maria Bamford.
Wow.
Wait, hold on.
Now, what is the difference? Answer your question. What is the difference between the Comedy Attic in Bloomington, Indiana, and that Comedy Attic in Amsterdam?
Well, one sells
pot. Oh, see, it's because it was like an Anne Frank.
No, they yeah. sell pot at the Comedy yeah. Attic in Amsterdam yeah. now.
I played the Comedy Attic in Bloomington. He's
it's
nice.
Great. He's great. He's a purist. He doesn't.
Yeah,
he doesn't even. He won't even sell hard liquor. He only sells beer and wine because he doesn't want them getting drunk.
Helium in. Minneapolis?
I'm not allowed to
Portland.
Work for the Helium Company.
No.
Acme?
I like Acme.
Lewis Lee?
I haven't played in Acme in years.
I like Lewis Lee.
Really? I like the Helium in Portland a lot.
Yeah.
They're really,
Wait,
really
you
hipsters.
Don't, you don't play Acme? And
I did
an album there, and Lewis and I spent the whole weekend drinking together, and I still can't get a fucking gig.
You can't play anywhere you want? No, I find that so pleasing
Can
to
you
my
shut
ears.
Up? Because I need to record a podcast
yeah,
with Greg
Proops. We have to go as well.
Yeah, okay. We all have
Thank
to
you, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.